So before we will proceed today with the different variations of the structures of LED. So let us have a quick recap, or if you have any doubts, hope that is going to clarify here. So because the concept what we have covered so far with respect to direct and indirect band gaps and other aspects of the LED structures, the heterogeneous structure. So how we are at the stage to improve the radiance and quantum efficiency of the LED. So what are the factors which are becoming responsible to enhance the performance of the LED structure? Because if you look at the contents which are prescribed by VTU in this module 3, so far so it contains three parts here, actually two parts only if you put the margin line. Optical sources actually concerned with the light sources, optical sources, which are used as a sources of photons at the transmitter side, and photodetectors, which are used the devices at the receiver side to reconstruct our message signal back. We, before concluding module 3, look at the overview of optical receiver as well. So to start with, in last few classes, we actually began with the basic concept of energy bands that has actually helped us to understand the direct and indirect band gap concepts. We started looking at the materials at the atomic level, consisting of three bands here: valence band, band gap, and that is the conduction band. And we all know that at the lowest temperature or at the room temperature, whatever the conductivity we will be having, that is remaining constant. Means the density of the charge carriers in both conduction and valence band remains same. And with the available initial energy, whatever they got, they moved across this band and made this some gap to exist between these two conduction and valence bands. So this band gap and energy gap is nothing but EG, that is indicated here, is going to be the difference between the EC and EV. EC, that is a electron concentration in the conduction band, EV, the charge concentration in the valence band. And their charge densities, the peak is normally you can see. So you can easily understand here with this, whatever the curve you are getting, the initial peak you are getting in a very less amount of time. Then it will goes on decreasing. You can see here, number of electrons will suddenly increase in a small amount of time. That is, I am talking about the temperature just beyond the room temperature. You bring the material and keep it in the room, that is at the room temperature. So it will take some time to adjust or attain to itself up to the room temperature. Till that, so this much peak you are getting. So this peak what you are observing, this peak you are getting. So once the peak is achieved here in both valence and conduction bands, means during this time what is happening is that your material is still attaining at the room temperature, And some of the charge carriers, majority of them, majority carriers in both conduction and valence band, trying to cross the band gap and thereby increasing the band gap which was existed before. And after that, you can see their density will goes on decreasing. So in the beginning, slowly it will go on increasing the band gap energy. Initially it is large, that's why more crossings are happening. And as the time lapses, it will decrease and reach some stable portions here. Both are equal. The density of charge carriers are attaining equal in numbers in both the bands and thereby attaining the constant band gap energy. This is what it is happening with the pure crystal. Pure crystal at lowest temperatures. And when the temperature rises, means up to room temperature we are taking, this will happen. So these things we already discussed. So with what force, why the electrons are going to bombard or vibrate? If EXT is an external force, mass of electron, and acceleration of the electron, the phased by the electron because of the crystal lattice structure. So next you can see there is a pure crystal you have seen. Now next we'll make it impure by doping some pentavalent or trivalent impurities. Pentavalent impurities are came from the fifth group of the periodic table. That is going to donate one extra electron. That's why you can see the ED level, the band gap level, little bit enhanced compared to the previous one. And that is going to increase the activity or the density of electrons in the conduction band, which are jumping more now this time from valence to conduction band compared to the previous case. So the electron density is more achieved in the conduction band than compared to the valence band whole concentration. So what is happening here is that, so we might be getting this doubt that, so with this statement that more electrons are jumping from valence to conduction band, it doesn't mean that they are leaving more holes at the back. This all the things are happening in a very short while, short span of time. So more electrons are contributed not because of the temperature anything here. The previous case it was temperature, now no temperature is there here. Now we are at the room temperature now. Your pure crystal already achieved some fixed band gap. Now it is at the room temperature. Then we are adding these fifth group elements, pentavalent impurities. Now because of this pentavalent impurity, what you are adding, arsenic, antimony or phosphorus to this any of the semiconductor material like silicon or germanium. It is a pentavalent, four of the valence electrons from this impurity will be joining and leaving one electron free. So it is here that is from the pentavalent impurity which is donating one extra electron, not because of the rise in temperature which is going to bombard the electrons in the valence band and making them to jump from valence to conduct. That is wrong. So that's why you can see. So what is happening is that the hole's density will be remaining same at the room temperature. We are not disturbing it, assuming this material is at the room temperature. Now at room temperature fixed, keeping that one in mind, we are adding the pentavalent impurity. It is because of the reaction between the pentavalent impurity and the pure crystal atoms. One extra electron we are getting. These five group elements are donating one extra electron. That's why they are known as donors, giving rise to N-type material. Or giving, why N-type? Because it is giving one extra electron, not hole. that is m, that is going to enhance the electron density suddenly in the conduction band and thereby enhancing the band gap energy ED. So this is how we are getting n type. Similarly, we can get the p type, that is a whole concentration. You can see the band gap energy is very much reduced. So this is the third group elements from periodic table, which have only three valence electrons. So one is acting like a hole in need of electron. So more deficiency or holes are created, which are in need of the electron in the valence band. This obviously is going to increase the hole concentration in the valence band as compared to conduction band. See, the holes will be there in the conduction band also, but they will be there as a minority. In valence band, electrons are there, but they are acting like a minority here. So this how the simply with the graph, how we are able to understand what is the things are happening with the pure crystal up to room temperature, then how we are going to use the pure crystal, add the dopings and get the N9 p-type materials. So with this basic concepts in mind, now we are going to the direct band gaps and indirect band gaps. So this concept actually, as the name suggests, is based on the band gap. Okay. So the statements, you can see the electron transitions are what are the crossings are happening between across the band gap, that is between the conduction and valence bands, depends on the momentum. And he is telling this is very important, momentum must be conserved. So what do you mean by this momentum? We know the previously how why the electrons are jumping from valence band to conduction band, that is F equal to ma. So they got vibrated. Because of this external force. Or you can say that because of the bombardment of the neighboring atoms, they got experiencing this force EXT, and they will become free, that is a valence electron, and they will be jumping. So momentum is quite different, it is related with the by virtue of the acceleration. So this hope the basic concept we learned all the way from the school days. Momentum is actually concerned with the, you can say it depends on the two factors. So one, the neighboring atoms, how they are vibrating, and the second thing, where exactly we are residing. The surface is smooth or rough by virtue of acceleration, that's what you are telling. Momentum. So electrons and holes should have the same momentum, that is going to give us the direct band gap, that's what he is quoting here. So in a direct band gaps, so band gap which is created by the majority carriers in the respect to conduction and valence band, majority carriers, now they got to have or assumed to have the same momentum. You can see here. See, the momentum, you can see, it depends on the many factors, depending on the situation. Not only just I told that it depends on the location or the situation or the place where they are residing, and also depends on the external force, how much they are experiencing. Many things will come into picture. So whatever it may be, the momentum is going to, in one way or the other, with what velocity the charge carriers are going to cross across the this band gap. That momentum, what is telling, is going to be equal here. So the radiation or leakage of information you can see. So for example, if the electron is falling from conduction to valence band, it is giving rise to the radiation in only one direction. That is a product of the Planck's constant and the velocity of electron. unidirectional we are getting because of the fixed band gap, and that is happening because of the equal amount of charges or and this one, the equal moment. If there is unequal moment, then we will not be getting this unidirectional photon energy. So that will come in the second case, that is indirect band gap. So here it is quoting the characteristics of characterizing the induction indirect band gap material. Conduction band minimum and valence band maximum energy levels occur at different values of momentum. So it is because of the contributed for the different momentums achieved by the electrons in the conduction band and those achieved by the holes in the valence band. So because of the difference in momentum, they have different timings to cross the gap. Here, for example, again he is taking the electrons are falling from conduction to valence band, and this is indicating the photon energy because at the moment when, so one thing you remember, if you want any majority charge to move from valence to conduction band, we have to give some energy. It requires it some absorption will happen, absorption of energy is required there. We'll have to boost some energy here, and then only electrons will become free by the bombardment or by facing that external force EXT, and then they will jump to conduction. They absorb, they are in need of energy. In the same way, the reverse thing will happen if you want electron to jump from conduction to valence band. No energy is required to make the electrons to jump. Only thing is this band gap. Jump, while they are jumping, whatever the energy they got, it will be liberated in the form of the photon energy, and that too occurs in only one direction in case of the direct band gap. But here it is because of unequal moment, we'll be getting the photons which are emitted when the electrons are jumping from conduction to valence band may be adding in one direction, that is energy due to, so this one, indirect band gap, and EPH, that is a photon energy. So these electrons which are having less momentum compared to the holes in the valence band, they have whatever may be. Because of unequal momentum, electrons are jumping, and they also got supplied with energy from the phonons here. And this already I might have told you when the phonons will be liberated during scattering, Rayleigh scattering. That is which one it is, modular type scattering, that is going to convert your photons coming from intensity modulated light into the phonons and scattered photons. So those phonons are contributing bit for the electrons also to jump from conduction band fall here. So this is what it is happening. So indirect band gap materials are characterized in such a way. The photon energy is more in one and less in another direction because they added and subtracted respectively. This is not the light what we are getting from the LED, the basic concept of the LED. The concept of LED depends on the spontaneous emission. It lies with the emission. How many electrons will be emitted from the conduction band to the valence band? It also refers, emission means it refers to the how many are jumping at a time, at a particular time. The emission also refers to at what time they are emitted or jumping, and it also refers to how much recombination is happening in the valence band, that is with the holes. It doesn't mean that all the 10 electrons which are falling here in valence band will be recombined. Of course, they are falling at different times. They are recombinant at different time. So that's why I'm telling the number which is falling and the number which is recombining in a particular time. Quote here, underline, in a particular time. Okay. So that is going to decide the radiance, the light emitted from the diode, that is LED. So this is going to be the emphasis for our next discussion, the LEDs. But while discussing so, the LED, which is actually based on the concept of spontaneous emission. In emission, emission means, always keep in mind, this word is actually refers to the things which are happening in the particular time. Timing is important here. So the density of the things which are recombining, recombination is happening, contributing for that. That is going to decide the number of the photons liberated or emitted actually. If you look at this particular picture, it is going to give you so another aspect of this LED. That is a diode itself. No, there is a light emitting. This is also a diode only. That too, now we are discussing with the homojunction diode, because normally what kind of diodes we have seen, PN diode, are made up of same type of atoms, maybe silicon or zirconium. That's why it is known as a homojunction. So this you have to understand, homojunction. So this one condition, what we are getting, putting here in the light emitting diodes is this one. Whatever the light, the photons which are got emitted from the recombination which is happening, we don't want all the light to be emitted in a particular time. We want it to be focused, coherent. That's why we are letting only those light rays which are occurring as a phenomenon of recombination, which are passing through this acceptance angle or the cone angle governed by this critical angle. So the cone which is formed by the critical angle, what in this cone, whichever the light rays are falling, are allowed to emit it. So while this is why we are doing, this is to achieve the coherency of the light, to enhance the radiance of the light. Two factors, both are different. Coherency means highly directional. It is related to the direction of the light. And radiance means the brightness of the photons. Both are different. But here the coherency is achieved, and little bit also helps in the achieving the radiance also. But while achieving that optical confinement, and the optical confinement means we are able to achieve the directional property, that is a coherency, and also we are going to achieve the radiance to some extent. We are solving the optical confinement, but we are left with the carrier confinement problem, because if you are letting only those photons or light rays to pass through this the cone governed by the critical angle, then what is happening with the remaining photons or light rays? They are now confined to this. That is a carriers means are now struck up here. Carrier confinement problem. Because of this, you can see the efficiency of the LED is less, in the range of 1 to 3.5 kT. K is the Boltzmann constant, T is the room temperature. Will be giving the band gap energy equal to the emitted, that of the emitted lights, photons. So emitted photons have the energy only that much, as it is equal to band gap, that is very much less. Band gap energy is after that. So this is how we are going to characterize LED having the homojunction. But on the other side, it will be giving you the wide optical bandwidth, a 6 dB down as compared to 3 dB down of your optical bandwidth. For typical gallium arsenide device, it will be around 30 to 40 nanometers. So to deal with these things, the problem of the carrier confinement, we'll be going for the introducing or double layer structure that is going to manage manufacture LED to be made up of sorry. Okay. So today, to avoid to minimize this carrier confinement problem, we are going for the heterojunction from the homojunction, where we can see both P and N type now are made up of a different type of material. For example, if you consider P from silicon and N from the another type of silicon material. So that will help us to resolve both the problems, the carrier confinement and the optical confinement problems. So moreover, it is also going to increase the efficiency of the LED. So likewise, we got the so far discussion. Two types of LED structures having homojunctions and heterojunctions. Yes. So the difference between the homojunction and heterojunction is clear. The one thing, same type of atoms, and here different types of atoms. So under homojunction, you will be getting surface LED, and here you will be getting a planar LED. There are two variations of LED that we are going to see later. So one of the structure what you have discussed in the last class is this gallium aluminium arsenide double heterostructure light emitter. This one already we have discussed. Just a recap we are doing here to resolve if you have any doubts to be clarified. So this one basically we are going to begin with. So it consists of three parts here for you to clarify the things here. It consists of A, B, and C. Three sections are there in this figure. You have to practice this diagram. And these refractive indices are just shown for your understanding purpose. It will be not there, and these things are not there. So only this is the box what I have put, only that much without RI. First we have to a structure is there, we have to explain its construction. That is heterogeneous construction made up of different types of P and N type layers made up of different type of silicon materials. It will indicate different layers available in the gallium aluminum arsenide double heterostructure light emitter. Totally it consists of seven layers, sections you can say, which are actually divided as per the figure C into five different levels as per their refractive index profile. Okay, so these seven different sections comprising to the structure of this typical LED are divided into five different layers based on the refractive index profile as shown in figure C. The first layer corresponds to metallic contact in n-type gallium arsenide substrate. And the fifth layer, which consists of the right side, that is another metallic contact and a p-type gallium arsenide. So this one is a metal contact improvement layer, means it is going to improve the metal contact and also helps in the heat dissipation. So this n-type gallium arsenide substrate and this is p-type gallium arsenide substrate, is this one is known as a metal contact improvement layer, means it is acting like a heat dissipator, thereby helping in improving the performance of this typical LED and also improve the metal contact. These two and these two, this one improve the metal contact, and this will be meant for as a substrate contributing for the majority carriers to be impinged into the this top layer of this n-type metal layers. So these two left and right side sections have got the lowest refractive index, as it is clear from the C figure. So the electron, if it want to jump, the band gap is very large because of their lowest index profile. So this all about the here left hand to right hand two sections what we have. Now left with only three middle regions here. So these three middle regions. Okay. So this one and this one, n-type gallium aluminum arsenide and p-type gallium aluminum arsenide. Figured it out as light guiding layers, and also they are acting like a carrier confinement. They are going to resolve the problem. And also look at the their dimensions. Now coming to the figure B. Okay, before that you can see this n-type gallium arsenide and this p-type gallium aluminum arsenide coming with region 2 and 4 of refractive index profile, having the index profile higher than that of the metallic contacts. And their resin width will be kept at around 1 micrometer. So typical values I have shown here, refractive index, what they have. Means they are acting like the cladding, because you are connecting your optical fiber that is going to sit here. So this is a cladding with the metallic contact using two extreme two layers of the on either side. Either the cladding Cat 6 of the optical fiber should resemble the properties of n-type and p-type these sections. Carrier confinement means they are acting like carrier confinement, means they are going to resolve that issue by having more density of charge carriers in the top layer. Because we want more density of electrons to be injected here. That is, injection is coming from this substrate. They are injected here, coming here, and falling here, and in the top layer of this n-type, then they are going to fall here. So we have the more density that is achieved with the 1 micrometer, that is very wide compared to 0.3 micrometer, that is a middle one that is acting like a core. So the middle n-type gallium aluminum arsenide is, that's why known as a recombination resin. Its width will be kept very, very small. That is just to increase the focus Because if you reduce the spot or the place where recombination is happening in a very small, if you make the recombination to happen, we'll be getting a very radiant electron hole recombination. Our photons will be liberated. You can see 829 meter photons will be liberated. So that is a carrier confinement is resolved by using these N and P type cladding layers, these two layers. They are also acting like light guiding lights, because once the electrons or photons are emitted, they are acting like a cladders, cladding these two, and going to match with the cladding of the optical fiber, and we'll see that the liberated photons will be reliably coupled to the optical fiber. That's why they are known as the light guiding layers. And because of the small band gap energy, we'll also see more whole recombination takes place, that in a small region. So these two are mainly responsible to get the more coherent light. So you can see its refractive index will be kept very large, core refractive index compared to the cladding. So this is how, guys, we are able to resolve both the carrier confinement problem with the help of these two layers, and optical confinement are also resolved by these two layers. These two layers. So the middle one mainly responsible for the active region. So this one is mainly responsible for the active region to generate more number of photons. Okay, we'll stop here. If you have any things to ask, so that why I kept the recap class today.